We're recording.
Welcome to session two of Capturing Your Transformation Journey. My name is Lloyd Turner, and I'm here today with Max and Carl Wallace on the content side, and Bob Krisiak is our Zoom administrator for the evening. So welcome, and if you're listening in on remote recording, we hope you'll have a good experience listening to this as well. Last week, we talked about the fact that everybody has a transformational story. It's just not so easy to share it with current technology. So what we're trying to do on this webinar is to make the technology easier for you to deal with so that you can get your message out to the world. Just to review the course objectives, we're going to show you how to use inexpensive tools to document your own transformation story, which could either be a personal transformation, transformation in your community, or a transformation in your nation. This four-part webinar will help you to share your stories with others in your sphere of influence. And tonight we're going to talk about how to use smartphone technology to capture your story, either on an iPhone or Android. And we're also going to talk about different types of cameras. Here in the slide, you can see my friend Felicia Osborne, who has a very interesting transformation story. She is here in Newark, New Jersey, and she works with patients who have substance abuse and mental health patients. And her story is about, quote, reaching the lost at any cost. So who's going to benefit from this course? Just by way of review, last week we showed you how to put a presentation together using any clips and photos that you have on hand. They could come from any camera that someone sent you or shots that you took yourself. They could come from smartphones. They could come from DSLRs. They could come from consumer level or professional video equipment. For tonight's session, we're going to recommend that you have either an iPhone or an Android type phone. It's probably easiest for you to compose your production on a PC or Mac or tablet, although you can also compose them on your phones. And we're also going to review some optional accessories that will help you tell your transformational story more easily. This is the second of four webinars. Last week we talked about how to create your first documentary video. And if you go back to the recording library, you can review that from last week and go through the steps. There are also PowerPoints, which Jill has sent out to you, which would allow you to review the steps on it. Tonight, we're going to show you how to enhance that promotional video. Then next week, we'll talk about how to produce a documentary film, how to render it and produce it in either online or DVD format. And then on the fourth session, we'll talk about how to share your videos with others. So for tonight, enhancing your documentary video, we're going to talk about using an external mic. We'll talk about some other features to enhance your video. This is an interview at the top here with Dr. Gloria Harris from Newark. And she was interviewed with us using a professional camera. And we used what's called a shotgun mic, which we'll introduce next week. Okay, so our agenda for tonight is five items. First of all, how to use an external microphone with a smartphone. Secondly, other smartphone accessories. Then Max Wallace and I will give you examples of two videos we've created on smartphones. Then we'll talk tonight about different types of cameras if you want to go beyond smartphone cameras. And then finally, I'll wrap up with a slide on additional resources that you might want to go through in order to learn more about camera video making technology. So let's begin with using an external mic. In the circle here on the slide, you can see lavalier mic, or lapel mic is another name for it, that I've plugged into the headphone jack on my smartphone. This is actually a Samsung Galaxy Tablet 3, rather than a smartphone, but it's the same principle with a smartphone. And I have it attached in a Gimars or Gimars stand and mounted on a tripod. So when I put this phone into the microphone jack, it recognizes that as a microphone rather than a headphone. And then when I pull it out, I can replay the video and hear the sound as if it were a headphone. Other accessories, this is the Jaymar smartphone holder, which is mounted on a tripod. And if you look at it, this is a standard floor tripod that uses a ball and pin connector. And then this is what's called a floating head tripod, which we'll talk about in a future session. Alternatively, we could mount it on a desktop, as I'll show you in a minute. Another thing that's useful to do with a smartphone is to put on clip-on lenses. So here in a circle, you see I have used a clip-on pin and put a lens on top of my camera lens. I've taken a picture of myself doing it. So what this does is it creates a wide angle lens that's multiplied 0.45 times wider than normal. It also has a macro lens if I wanted to take a picture of something that was smaller. So in this particular scene, I use what's called a universal YXW1 SLR clip-on device. And I've put this on a desktop tripod, which is actually quite handy. And it's a aluminum desktop tripod from XIT Photo, and it sells for about $50. So it's a nice thing to put on your desk. You can raise it to the right height and then video yourself at the desk. Okay, so we're now up to section three, which is smartphone video examples. I'm going to introduce my colleague, Max Wallace, and Max is going to show you a video that he created on his iPhone. So okay. Max, I'll turn it over to you.
Okay. Here we go. Can you see it yet? Or
yes, it's coming. Yep, there we go.
Okay, so let's play it. Is it working?
Yes.
One of my first experiences of transmission was coming back from Argentina, having learned about the power of blessing to change a spiritual climate and to impact my sphere of influence, and being a Pilates trainer and a rehab specialist for spinal injuries, instead of just doing my job, instead of just getting by, I started to personally bless each one of my clients. And as I would do that, I started to notice that God would give me kind of wisdom and insights into particular exercises and movements to do that I'd not been trained in. Sometimes it was time in my life.
Interesting.
That I'd not really learned before, and I started to put it into practice and found that I had results that were amazing, and I became very well known for working this way with clients locally, even though I wasn't a doctor and I wasn't a chiropractor. I was a sports therapist, but it gave me a lot of favor. I was able to impact my sphere of influence with a much greater depth than I had expected before.
Good job.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Can you talk about it?
Okay, so Max, can you give us a minute or two to tell us, how did you create your video? What were the steps that you used?
We went to the Harvest office and we filmed it on an iPhone 6S Plus right here, like this, I took the video home and I edited it. Like, I put it on my iPad because it's a bigger screen, easier to like see what I'm doing. And then I added like a little beginning thing like you saw, and then I put her video in, and I put went in the video, and if there was like a spot that wasn't good, I would fix it up. And then the end of it, I put a like a transition, so it kind of faded into that, and then it went to just say thank you for your testimony.
Okay, that's great. So if other people have questions, would you be able to help them do this as well?
Sure.
Yeah, Laura, I had a question, real quick one. Max, did you hold it with your hand or did you have some kind of a tripod?
We held it, so it might be a little shaky.
It didn't shake at all. It was very well.
Okay. Thank you.
So I have a question. It might be a technical question, and it might the video that I saw tonight, we'd actually seen it before, and it was less jumpy. And I'm trying to figure out why. Oh, is it the Zoom problem that it didn't seem to present as well?
Or, yeah.
Okay.
It must be because it's perfect on this site.
Yeah, because if I look at it on like my iPad, it's perfect quality. Sometimes when you're a video call or something that's streaming all over, it's like it's not good quality. So
okay.
If I look at it on my iPad, it looks really nice. So if I sent it to you in high quality somewhere, it would look nicer.
Well, looking at it right here, that is recorded in
Dropbox.
Dropbox is what we're doing tonight, and it's clear on Dropbox.
Okay, so it displays better on your desktop or on a website than it does on Zoom, I guess.
Yeah, it seems to. Yeah, I mean, I can't see your side, but our side was crystal clear.
Okay, yeah, it was a little it lagged a little bit here, but that's probably something about the Zoom technology.
Yeah,
or maybe just tonight.
Okay, so I'll tell you what then. I will take control now, and I'll show you my video clip, and we'll see if we have the same issue on mine, okay?
Okay.
Thanks very much, Max.
You're welcome.
Okay, so what I've done, I have a video about how to use an external microphone, and I just pasted this into my PowerPoint deck, so let's see how it plays on PowerPoint, okay? Go to.
I want to see this video.
Today, you can use several types of smartphones and tablets to record quality videos. The most popular types of smartphones are the Apple iPhone and the Samsung Galaxy, the latter which has an Android operating system. Both the iPhone and the Galaxy series phones have high quality video capabilities. The Apple and Samsung tablets also produce excellent videos. Unfortunately, however, today's smartphones and tablets are rather limited in terms of audio quality. To be sure, if you're shooting a selfie video and are right next to the phone or tablet, you will get an acceptable quality audio track. But the quality of the audio fades quickly when you move even a few feet away from the phone and attempt to interview someone else. An easy solution to this problem is to attach an external microphone to your smartphone or tablet. The best device I've found is the Miracle Sound Lavalier microphone, which works for most Android or iPhone devices as well as many tablets. It comes with a 59-inch extension cord so that you can use it to interview someone sitting a few feet away from you. You can also use an extension cord if your subject is more than 59 inches from you. In this video, I've plugged the Miracle Sound microphone into the headphone jack of my Samsung Galaxy 3 tablet. This tablet has 16 gigabytes of native memory, and I've added another 64 gigabytes of memory with an SDXC high-capacity memory card, which is readily available online or at your local electronics store or drugstore. The Miracle Sound Lavalier microphone clips to your lapel, as you can see here, and produces a superior sound compared with the mic that is in your smartphone. It works on Samsung Galaxy 5, 6, and 7 models, as well as the iPhone 6. Since it plugs into a headphone jack on your phone, it will not work on the iPhone 7 model, which does not have an external headphone jack. If you use the iPhone 7, therefore, you'll need to look for a wireless microphone that interfaces well with your smartphone. The Miracle Sound Lavalier microphone, like the internal microphone on your smartphone, is omnidirectional, meaning that it captures sound from all directions. But since you clip it to your lapel, almost all of the sound it records will come directly from the voice of the person you are interviewing. It sells for approximately $16 from Amazon.com and from other online retailers.
Okay, so how did that display for you folks?
Pretty well. It was a little I think if we watched it in high definition, set really well, it'd be much clearer. But for this, it's pretty good right now.
Yeah. What, Bob, how did it look from your end?
The video quality looked real nice, Lloyd. It was fine. The audio didn't have very much bass in it. A little high pitch.
Okay.
Otherwise, it was still audible. It was fine.
Okay. You know, it might be useful for me to play the earlier version of Max's video just to see if a low-res one plays better. Should we do that?
Sure. Should I play it or do you have it?
I'll play it. I have it on my PowerPoint deck here.
Okay. Oh, that's worse.
One of my first experiences of transformation was coming back from Argentina, having learned about the power of blessing to change a spiritual climate and to impact my spiritual influence. And being a Pilates trainer and a rehab specialist for spinal injuries, instead of just doing my job and instead of just getting by, I started to personally bless each one of my clients. And as I would do that, I started to notice that God would give me kind of wisdom and insights into particular exercises and movements to do that I had not been trained in. Sometimes it would come in my mind like a picture. Sometimes I would like play in a video as I was blessing them and praying over their lives and their families. I would get a picture or a sense of a way to do an exercise and a rehab exercise that I had not really learned before. And I started to put it into practice and found that I had results that were amazing. And I became very well known for working this way with clients locally, even though I wasn't a doctor and I wasn't a chiropractor. I was a sports therapist, but it gave me a lot of favor and I was able to impact my sphere of influence with a much greater depth than I had expected before.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the internet connection.
So let me ask Max and Carl, how did that look for you and how did it sound?
Well, it wasn't even as good as the one you just played a second ago. It was like really crumbly and it was like, and the audio wasn't that good. And
are you saying the first one was better?
Yeah, and the one I played was just better. Even the way we downloaded it onto Dropbox, that one we downloaded before we downloaded the second one, it was like that. So I think going with the higher definition one is going to be a better idea.
Yeah, on our screen here, it looked better on the low-res version, and the audio was better as well.
Yeah, it was definitely easier to understand it on the low-res from the Zoom. So it's just interesting how all the technology works together. It was so jumpy that I could barely understand what was being said in the earlier version. And this one, again, the video wasn't as clear. You know, it was certainly a lower resolution, but the audio and the video worked together better.
The second one?
The second one, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Bob, let's hear your point of view. You saw it both ways.
I think with the one you just played, Lloyd, from within PowerPoint, the video wasn't as clear.
No.
Say Max's was a little blurry, but the audio was actually a little bit better. It wasn't as jumpy as the first one.
Wow.
Okay. So interesting. I think what we might conclude from this is that if we had a higher res version in my PowerPoint, that might be the optimal way to project it.
And your audio, your video that you played, Lloyd, was probably related to the mic that you were using.
It was what?
With Max's video, there was no audio problem. I could hear it fine.
Okay. All right. Well, we're learning some lessons here about different alternatives in showing smartphone videos. So hopefully we can have some dialogue about this in the future and come up with a best recommendation. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm going to move on to the next item then. So we've talked about iPhones. We've talked about Android phones, specifically the Samsung Galaxy. And that's just one class of cameras that you can use to prepare documentary videos. There are three other classes of cameras that I'd like to review on this call. The second one is called small compact cameras, or also known as point and shoot. And those are very popular, and there's a lot of different types of those. The third class is called DSLR cameras, which stands for digital single lens reflex. And the fourth one's called mirrorless cameras. So in this section, I'll review the different types of cameras, and then I'll do a comparison slide of what some of the pros and cons are of different cameras, okay? So first, smartphones. As you know, there's billions of people around the world that have smartphones today. There are a lot of different varieties. Here in the U.S., the Apple iPhone and the Samsung Galaxy are probably the leading models, although LG and other companies, Nokia, have other types of phones that are good as well. So smartphone videography is becoming increasingly popular, and there are several reasons for that. Number one is once you buy the smartphone, the camera part is free. Of course, the initial investment is somewhere between $600 and $1,000 if you were to buy the phones outright. Or what a lot of people do, like, including ourselves, is we just finance them through our cell phone plan. Second point is that the quality of the cell phone videos improves with each generation. We see more and more pixels as each generation comes along, and the color quality is better and the features and functions are better. Thirdly, we're seeing that the smartphones today typically have two cameras in them. You have a high quality camera for shooting remote subjects, and then you have a lower res camera for shooting selfies in the selfie mode. And then the other final attraction of this is that you can easily upload your videos to social media or send them in text or email messages to your friends. Okay, so the next type of cameras that you might consider would be the point and shoot cameras. These have been around a long time, at least since the Kodak Instamatics, and they range anywhere from $40 US to over $700. The main features of them is that they have a low purchase price, they're lightweight, they have quality videos that they produce. Typically, you only get the autofocus mode, meaning that the camera decides what settings to use for your video, which makes it very easy to shoot if you're a beginner or don't want to be bothered with complex light meters and other settings. Typically, you have one fixed lens in the camera, which is often a zoom lens, which may be 24 to 70, maybe 28 to 100, maybe 24 to 100 millimeter range. The longer the range is, the more you can zoom out to a far distance. And the more expensive models, such as the Nikon Coolpix B700 below at $450, includes features like Wi-Fi data transfers, which you're obviously not going to get in the $50 Vivitar Vivicam S137. The third class of cameras is called DSLRs, digital single lens reflex. Now, in the analog film days, they had single lens reflex cameras, which had a lens in it that had a reflecting mirror. And the purpose of the reflecting mirror is to bounce the light up so that you could see through the viewfinder. And then when you're taking the picture, the mirror goes down, you get a little bit of noise out of that, and then the camera flashes. The same principle has been captured with the digital SLR cameras or DSLRs today. And this is the camera of choice for many enthusiasts as well as professionals. So, the main features of these cameras are you get very high quality videos, typically in the 24 to 42 megapixel range. You can put in a wide range of interchangeable lenses, even across vendors. So you can get anywhere from a wide angle lens to a telephoto lens that'll fit on your camera. Typically, it'll have manual and program and autofocus modes as well, so you can do some adjustment in the manual mode or semi-manual mode if you want. And this is a big thing, that the DSLRs have, to a large extent, replaced camcorders because they have larger sensors than the camcorders and give you a superior low-light capability. And they may have what we call a half-frame or a full-frame sensor. The more advanced ones have features such as Wi-Fi transfer, white balancing, etc., which are generally included in the price of the camera. Some of these features are available on the smartphones, but they're apps that you would add in they're not shipped out of the box with these features. And the prices for the DSLRs range all over the board from $400 for the Pentax KS1 to almost $3,000 for the Nikon D810. And that, as you can see, that's only with the body. You'd have to pay extra for the lens. And so you're talking a $4,000 investment or more if you get a couple quality lenses with it. And then finally, they have what are called mirrorless cameras, which have fewer moving parts than the DSLRs. And the consequence of it is that you get less camera noise, particularly when you're zooming or clicking the image. The main features of these are similar to the DSLRs. You can get high quality videos up to 42 megapixels today. You can use a wide variety of interchangeable lenses. You have manual and program modes as well as autofocus. They may have a half frame or a full frame sensor, and they range anywhere from $400 or less. This Nikon One S2 is actually $250 and includes two lenses, to over $3,000 for the camera body. The one that I like and use is called a Sony A7 II. It's about $1,500 US, and then you pay for a lens or two on it. That brings it a little over $2,000. So, now this is the last slide that we'll talk through tonight. And I've tried to put together on one slide a comparison of what you get with different types of cameras. So, for example, in the pixel range, the smartphones typically go up to 12 megapixels for the primary lens, and the selfie lens is 7 megapixels on the Apple iPhone 7 Plus, and it's 5 megapixels on the Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge. When you get to the point-and-shoot cameras...
Oh, glitched.
Oh, you okay?
We just lost the connection.
Oh, you lost the connection. Bob, are you still seeing it?
It just came back. It just came back.
Oh, okay.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Wonderful. Okay, the point-and-shoot cameras will run up to 12 to 16 megapixels. And the DSLR and the mirrorless cameras will go typically 24 to 42 megapixels. So you have a very high pixel range with these two high-end cameras. The next thing is called the ISO range. And what that is the amount of magnification of the sensor that you get with the camera. So with the iPhone 7 and with the Samsung Galaxy, you'll get up to 800 ISO, which is pretty standard. 100 is a low ISO range. The Samsung Galaxy will actually go down to 20, so it's a little more light sensitive at the low end. The point-and-shoot cameras will go up to 12,800 ISO, and the DSLRs and mirrorless cameras will go up over 50,000. So they'll actually go from a 25 to 50,000 or more range. And why that's important is if you're trying to do advanced photography, it gives you a lot more control over color and balance and that sort of thing. Now, this next row here is called the sensor size. And you can see that the smartphones and the point-and-shoot cameras typically have what's called a half-frame sensor, which is 0.33 to 0.38 inches. And the DSLRs and the mirrorless cameras will have what's called a full-frame sensor, which is in the 0.55 range or higher. And what that does is, for example, a 0.55 will get almost twice as much light as you would get from an Apple iPhone 7, allowing it to do really nice shots in low light situations. In terms of interchangeable lenses, so I showed you an example of a clip-on lens that you can use with Apple or Samsung phone, and there's several makes of these that you can get. Typically with the point-and-shoots, you don't get interchangeable lenses. You just get the lens that's on the camera. And with the DSLRs and mirrorless cameras, your lenses are fully interchangeable. So you can use pretty much any lens that you have, but you may need an adapter to do that. Next point of comparison is, can you use an external microphone with the camera? And with the Apple through version 6, they had a headphone jack that you'd plug into, as I mentioned before. iPhone 7, I believe you would connect in through the power charger to make a headphone connection. With the Samsung Galaxy 7, you can use external mic as we demonstrated before. With the point-and-shoot cameras, there's basically no way to put in an external mic. So those are really more useful for photography, for portrait photography, than they are for videos. And with the DSLRs and the mirrorless cameras, typically they have a port where you can plug in an external mic. And we'll talk about a Rode microphone next week, which is a pretty good external mic to use for those cameras. With the Zoom, the Zoom is electronic on the Apple and the Samsung phones, so that's quiet. But on the point-and-shoot cameras and the DSLRs, you get a physical shutter, and those typically generate some noise, which can interfere with your audio track. And in the mirrorless camera, since there's no mirror to move around, you can actually have what's called a silent mode. So the mirrorless cameras are actually quieter than the DSLRs. And then the price ranges. As we mentioned, the smartphones are included, including cameras when you buy them. Point-and-shoot cameras, $40 to $700. And the other two cameras start at $400 and will go $3,000 or more just for the body of the cameras. So that's a quick summary. Let me stop right there and ask if anyone on the call has questions. Go ahead, Max.
About the external mic, with the iPhone 7, I know they removed the headphone jack for waterproofness, which is, I don't like that they did that, but the phone comes with an adapter or something that would, like, go into the headphone jack, like you said, but I think that it might affect the quality or something, so it's like, even though the 7 Plus has a really good camera, that the microphone and all that functionality might be a little bit choppy because of the connection.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I'm glad you mentioned that, Max. You might want to check that out in the next few days and see if you can get a good quality external mic connection through that adapter.
Okay.
Any other questions, Bob? Are there any chat questions for us at this point?
I don't see any chat questions, but just a comment about the DSLRs. I have a Nikon myself that I use for videos, birthdays, holidays, and any other scene that I want to capture. And I find it really easy to use. It takes pretty good videos as well.
Okay.
The other comment I want to make about the DSLRs, your video is as good as the lens you use. And the camera bodies themselves tend to be unamplified. The lenses can be twice as much as the camera body. Huh. You want to get a good lens. So, but there are some alternatives you can use, little cheaper lenses, which will do just well. They'll be fine, but if you look at the photographers on TV, those lenses that they have are very expensive.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. As I've looked around, I've seen that Canon and Nikon seem to have the most numbers of lenses, yeah. Although there's Zeiss and other manufacturers make a lot of lenses as well. So a lot of people will buy a Canon camera and just stay in the Canon family when they upgrade. Now, on my camera, I have a Sony mirrorless camera, Sony A7 II. And it comes with Sony lenses that I can purchase, which are rather limited in number. Sony doesn't have nearly as many lenses as Canon and Nikon do. But they do have something called an A-frame to E-frame adapter. So I bought one of those, and I can use a Canon lens on my Sony camera. There's also something called a legacy lens, which was 10 years or older. They didn't have the same electronics in the cameras. So with the legacy lens adapter, you can get the photograph you want in manual mode, but none of the autofocus features will work. So, for example, I have a 400 millimeter lens that I bought 10 years ago, and I got an adapter. I plugged it into my Sony camera, and it works fine. I just have to twist the adjustment on it manually because it doesn't autofocus.
Yeah, the other thing too with the digital SLRs, if you want to, you can manually focus it yourself. You don't have to use the sensor in the lens to focus.
That's it.
You could do that too. So that'll eliminate the noise for the audio.
It's true.
Okay. We will take additional questions if they come in, but in the meantime, let me point your attention to the additional resources slide, which is the next to the last slide in my deck. And there's three classes from Udemy.com, which is an online course company that's out of the Silicon Valley. Phil Ebener has a very good course on video editing for PC users with Project Director, which we mentioned last time. Rob Montgomery has a comparable one for iPhone filmmaking using iMovie. I'd recommend those. And then Phil Ebener also has a very good course on how to use DSLRs, which you can purchase from Udemy and watch at your leisure. These courses are typically not expensive, generally under $50 a course, and you get permanent access to them if you purchase them. So if you're interested in more about any of these topics, I'd be glad to give you some advice, but these would be very good courses for you to consider. Any comments, further comments from Carl or Maxie or anyone on the call? Okay, well, hearing none, let me close this in a word of prayer, and we'll be back same time, same place next week for webinar number 3. So, Father God, we do thank you for this time together. We thank you for the technology that you've given us to share our transformational stories. And we bless everyone who listens to these messages, that they would get some ideas about how to tell their own transformational story and those of people in their sphere of influence. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, guys.
All right. Thanks, Max. Thanks, yep. Bob. Thanks, Carl.
And good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.
Bye.
Bye. See you next time.
Oh. Hello. Is Marilyn available?